ESP.
Welcome to PSP eRally. Please feel free to post your question using the Q&A function on Zoom or comment on Facebook Live. In your question, you may like to identify yourself and which constituency you're in. And all right, without further ado, I shall now hand over to our moderator, Mr. Craig Teo, to kickstart our third eRally session. Craig, over to you.
Hi, thank you very much there. That was Grace doing the voiceover. Hi, good evening, Singapore, and welcome to the third of our eRally to reach out today in particular to the people who are staying, the residents and the voters in Choa Chu Kang GRC, including Hong Kah North, that's the SMC, and also for Marymount. And so I'd like to welcome everyone joining us live on Zoom and on Facebook Live. So ladies and gentlemen, the attendance of people who are coming in has been picking up, and we're going to be, for those who are joining us for the first time, what we're going to be doing tonight is we'll be introducing the candidates who are all from PSP. Firstly, will be the candidates who are from the Choa Chu Kang GRC, followed by Jejin Wong, who is from the Hong Kah North, and last but not least, Dr. Ang Yong Guan, who is standing as the SMC of Marymount. So before we get into the introduction of the candidates, just like to bring everyone up to speed on some of the things that has happened. And the latest I heard, okay, the latest news is that our Secretary General, Dr. Tan Cheng Bock, and the chairman of SDP, Paul Tambaya, has challenged Gan Kim Yong and Chun Seng. Chan Chun Seng, we fondly call him Cotton Chan, and you all know why. They say that the opposition has got no plan on how to deal with Singapore for the COVID situation or even post-COVID. So they have challenged them to a debate on TV. Now the ball has been set, has been thrown out to them. Let's see if Mr. Gan Kim Yong, who's the health minister, and Mr. Chan Chun Seng, who is the trade and industry minister, will take up the challenge and have a TV debate with Dr. Tan Cheng Bock and Paul Tambaya, who is the chairman of SDP, who is an infectious disease specialist. Oh, so that's the latest thing that is happening right now. The challenge has been issued. Will they be able or dare to step up to take on this challenge from Dr. Tan Cheng Bock and Paul Tambaya? So that's the latest, folks. And also in the meantime, before we bring on the candidates, let me just introduce to some of the merchandise that you may want to buy and support PSP. We have our merchandise for sale at this shop called Passions at Marina Square Shopping Mall. The unit is 02-332B. It's at the site that is nearest to Pan Pacific Hotel, because Marina Square is quite a big shopping mall. So rather than make you walk all over, it is at the site that's nearest to Pan Pacific Hotel. And it's open daily from 1 p.m. to 8 p.m. So if you want to buy our Otika Otter, our mascot, our lovely mascot, it's $30 each. You buy two, you get some discount, $50 for a pair. And the cap is at $10 each, including the round neck t-shirts, which is at $15 each. So once again, if you want to go and support PSP, because we need funds, you know, to participate in the GE, it's quite an expensive affair, please support us by going to buy our merchandise. And for those of you who want to make some donations to our funds for this GE, okay, this is now on screen. You may take a screenshot, is the easiest if you can take a screenshot, and you can send the funds to us either by PayNow, and it's a DBS Bank UEN number, and the number is T19. There's a SS, not 55, but SS0061, and the alphabet at the back is England, Holland, Osaka, London. And you need to indicate the donation amount, your contact name and number, okay? That's very important. You can also write us a check, write it to Progress Singapore Party, and you can then mail it to PSP Party HQ, 170 Upper Bukit Timah Road, Hex 14-04 Bukit Timah Shopping Centre. And the postal code there is 588179. And for those of you who want to scan the QR code, you may do so, and that will bring you to our website where the donation form is located there. And for those of you who are wondering why are we asking for contact numbers and names, right? It is not because we want to. This is a provision that has been set up by the Elections Department. The Elections Department, (ELD), has informed all political parties that this record-keeping requirement, including the provision of contact number, supersedes the confidentiality provisions under the Personal Data Protection Act, otherwise known as PDPA. So that's why, and PSP will ensure that all information provided is kept strictly confidential. So for those of you who want to make a political donation, you must remember this thing. Only Singaporeans are allowed to make donations to political parties, and you must be above the age of 21. So once again, only Singaporean citizens are allowed to make donations to political parties, and you must be above the age of 21. And it's for very obvious reasons, because the government does not want outside powers to interfere and try to affect the outcome of the general elections of the country. So our fate going forward can only be decided by Singaporeans and no one else. And I think that's a very, very good rule or consideration to have pertaining to political donations. So without further ado, okay, before I forget, can we bring on another slide, please, which talks about a comedy skit in a way, where it's a political skit, but done in a comedy style using the characters of Wang Sai and Ye Feng. This was out in the Sing Ming Pao yesterday, because in PSP, we have produced a video and it is in dialect to reach out to the pioneer generation, okay? Because many of the pioneer generation are a bit lost. Some of them are not even aware that maybe Mr. Lee Kuan Yew is no longer around. So this through this video, we highlight to all the people in the pioneer generation what are some of the issues, okay? And it's all done in dialect, a mixture of dialect, but mostly in Teochew. So, Sita Teochew. So, it's me acting in that video together with an actor friend of mine, and Doc was also speaking in Hokkien, telling the people in the video that, especially for the seniors who are in the pioneer generation, to be careful of their health when they go for this thing. And that he actually objected to this election being held during a pandemic crisis, but we still went ahead. So, he asked the seniors there, who are Singaporeans, because voting is compulsory in Singapore, please take good care when you go and cast your vote. Okay, folks, without further ado, it's now time for me to bring on one by one the candidates. I'll bring them all. Can all the candidates please bring on your videos, switch on your videos so that we can see all of you, and we'll introduce them. And here they come on screen. We have now all my good people. Let me just call up your name so that when you wave, we can see you. And I still wish, where's Rahman? Where is Rahman? Never mind, we'll wait for him to come. Here he comes. Okay, so the first person, I'd just like to very quickly say hello to everyone, is wave your hands when I call out your name, is Francis, Yuan Kinping, Francis. So just wave your hands so everyone know who you are. That is the suave-looking Francis. Okay, who's a captain of industry. The next person I'd like to introduce very quickly to everyone is Tan Ming Hua, the professor. Okay, that's Ming Hua there, the one, you look very serious with the white hair, so cool, man. Okay, after that, the next person is Abdulrahman. Rahman, let's just wave your hand so everyone know who you are. Excellent, thank you very much. And the youngest, okay, who made history, parliamentary history in Singapore, standing for an election, is our lawyer-to-be, undergoing training still and studying at NUS, Sean, Chu Sean Ming. That's Sean, wave your hand, Sean. Just let everyone know who you are. Thank you very much. Okay, the four of these gentlemen are in Choa Chu Kang GRC. They have been pounding the streets there, doing their walkabouts. I'm sure you would have bumped into them, hopefully. All right, now we go to the last two persons. And the next one I want to introduce is the one that is very popular. Her name is Jijin Wong, and she is in Hong Kong. Now, Jijin, just wave to everyone first. You will have a chance to talk to everyone when your time is, we allocated the time for everyone to share. And last but not least, okay, is the one that also needs no introduction. Most Singaporeans know him. That is Dr. Ang Yong Guan. And he is in the SMC, the single member constituency of Marymount. So we have introduced all the panelists for this evening. It is the combined team of Choa Chu Kang GRC together with Hong Kong North SMC and Marymount SMC. Now, without further ado, Singaporeans, I would like to now introduce the video for Yuan Kinping Francis. And after this, he will take the floor and he will give his rally speech. My tech team, if you are ready, can we roll the video, please, for Francis, Yuan Kinping. Thank you.
I'm Francis Yuan. My parents passed away when I was a teenager. I live in Smith Street with my grandma.
There you go. There's the house I used to live in.
childhood days are tough, you know. I've got 8 brothers and sisters. They are asleep, I turn on the lights and then I do my work. We grew up with no expectation we are entitled to anything, only with the expectation that we are going to work hard. I joined the Air Force as a young man, almost 18 years of my life in various roles of leadership. Subsequently, I went on to the private sector, working as a CEO and a business leader in the region. Global companies like Honeywell, Ingersoll Rand, ST Aerospace and Hong Leong Asia. A country is not a company. Taking people as economic digit, where GDP counts, where material success counts, and happiness does not really feature just as important. I spend a lot of time playing for charity. There are a lot of residents who are very deprived. And when you hear a band playing, the glow on their faces and the smile, we find it very satisfying. To be in government, we ought to be serving the people and not the other way around.
Thank you very much there. That was the short intro video for Yuan Jinping, Francis. And the floor is yours. Say hello to the voters in Choa Chu Kang, GRC.
Thank you, Craig. Hello to all fellow Singaporeans and residents of the Choa Chu Kang, GRC. You have just seen a short clip, and I hope you also have seen the rally recordings, the recorded rally speech early on as well. I would just like to touch upon a few points and not to belabor what I said earlier. But having been around for the last few days and listening to news of what the BAP has said, you will have known that they have been talking about getting a fresh mandate, clearing the deck so that they could handle this crisis with confidence. And Minister Chan Chun Sing has also come up and said that the opposition ought to show their plans to handle the COVID crisis. And as Craig mentioned, Dr. Tan, and together with Dr. Paul Tambia, has now thrown this challenge to Minister Chan and Minister Gan Kim Yong to come up on the national TV debate on how we could handle the COVID crisis better. I hope they will take up this challenge and we would hear from their mouths what should be done and what could be done and how we could have done it better. But talking about this strong mandate, the PAP has a strong mandate for years, especially for the last 5 years since 2015, when they won a landslide victory. But since then, what has happened? This strong mandate doesn't help to make sure that the COVID crisis is handled and handled well. Yes, everybody tries their best. We're not faulting the government for not doing anything. But what we are saying is that gone is the time where only one party has all the answers and all the talent to help to put to bear to solve crises of this magnitude. It is time for talent outside the ruling party to come forward and be given a chance to get together, operate collaboratively to look at how we could do a better job to face the challenges we're going to face during this crisis. And more importantly, after this crisis, we should be now thinking of what's going on, what's going to happen 6 months from now. The businesses, especially the smaller ones, are under life support in the ICU. But when they come out of ICU, you need to help to nurture them back to health, so that they can continue to operate to sustain the 70% of the workers they hire. If they don't survive, jobs won't survive either. So we are not talking about who can handle things better. We are talking about the mentality of marshalling talent that is no longer the monopoly of the PAP. So that is one about building the wanting a strong mandate. I think it's totally irrelevant. Strong mandate doesn't mean strong performance, as you all have seen. And even before the crisis, a strong mandate they have not made the economic structure any better. We have relied on industries that are very vulnerable, tourism being one, and now we will have a hard time recovering from it. What more important is the tactic of fear. We just heard from Minister Chan that you wake up one day and find that you have a totally new government. Now, that is possible, but highly unlikely. I would say the opposite. You wake up one day and find that you have totally zero opposition in parliament. And that is possible and highly likely if we don't vote wisely. You would rather have constructive alternative parties like PSP going into the parliament to make sure, one, we provide constructive solution and ideas, diversity of ideas to parliament to engage in robust, vigorous debate so that the best policies in the interest of the people can come forward. Number two, we ought to serve as a check and balance in parliament to make sure that any excesses is prevented in terms of frivolous spending. Anything that is done not in the interest of the people should not be done, because we are a party with a heart, with compassion. And I told the reporter, I think the other day, that the trouble with PAP is that they hear, but they don't listen. We hear, but we listen. Because we've got a heart, we listen with our heart. We hear with our ears, but we listen with our heart. And that makes a difference, because you need somebody to be good check and balances, not to block or fix the government, but to offer constructive and strong checks to parliament. The third is to ensure transparency, accountability in parliament. Whatever we do, PAP has been touting we are transparent, we have been accountable. You are the best judge for it. We don't have to say yes or no, but I think you see for yourself. There are a lot of things that are not transparent at all. You don't have transparency, you don't have information, then kind-hearted people with a good heart who wants to help the country to solve problems can't do it, because you don't have the numbers to understand what really the fundamentals and the issues are. So transparency is important. Accountability is even more important. You know, and making sure that there's no conflict of interest when you appoint people to high position, and make sure that the process is transparent and is a fair process, and encourage and support meritocracy. So that is where we say having a strong mandate is not a question. Clearing the deck is just an excuse. Actually, by having a strong mandate, you actually end up with very little diversity. You end up with a tendency of the ruling party stifling dissent and bulldozing their own policies to suit their agenda. The other thing that I want to mention here is the solving of the crisis today. We have not seen beyond what is 6 months. A lot of money assistance schemes have been thrown, whether it be job support schemes, to the SME, and they are the backbone of our economy. It's the engine of growth. But what is going to happen after that? How is the economy going to be restructured to make sure that we cater for the short-term crisis and the longer-term sustainable structure so that jobs continue to be there? You can talk about retraining of people, but if they're being retrained for jobs that does not exist, then it's a waste of time for the mid-career professional, and also the waste of money and resources from our reserve. So we need to be clear on what is a strategic plan. How do the GLC play a role to establish the external wing? I was an expatriate in China, and I work in China, and they do not call me a foreign talent. I'm just a work permit executive. You know? The Chinese know there are people coming in to work to to help the economy to grow through foreign companies. They welcome us, but at the same time, we as big companies are responsible enough to have a policy to localize. So we train local Chinese to take over our jobs. If it's a top job, maybe two rounds of expatriate, the third one will be a local. Like the one who succeeded me was a foreigner, but the one who succeeded the foreigner is a local. That is a kind of policy that you could encourage in Singapore to make sure that works as well. Where big companies here localize, our company go overseas to create external wing where our own PMET can go overseas to work and establish a real external wing for young people and executive. Yes, here we still need foreigners to help and complement, but we are not giving our own Singaporeans the opportunity to get jobs that they can be trained to go to higher level. They are being displaced. I was in a debate on Monday. We talked about this subject, and I said there are about 400,000 foreign, so-called foreign talent working here, PMETs, and we have, I quoted 100,000. Of course, MOM came back the next day and said that it is 39,000, but that was June last year. We have forgotten that it's 1 year ago. So our calculation shows that essentially, according to what MOM has said, 70% of unemployed retrenched are PMET. So if the assessment this year is 100 to 200,000, we take the lower figure, 100,000, you take 70% of that, it's 70,000. You add to the 39,000, it's over 100,000. Plus those who are graduating from universities, polytechnic, more than 30,000. So you take a ballpark number, it doesn't matter whether it is exactly 190, 80, 110. The proof of the matter is that if you've got 400,000 people, foreigners working here, don't tell me you cannot free up in a matter of maybe months that number of PMET that are out of job to be given an opportunity. That is an immediate way to solve the problem. But to us, it's more important to solve the problem after the 6 months. So coming back again to the point, BSP have the talent to be a constructive so-called alternative to give ideas. Our team in CCK is an example. Okay. Myself being an executive who has got experience to share, hopefully to be, again, of value. We've got Dr. Tan Ming Wah, who is an economist, who understands a lot of the intricacies of the economic situation in Singapore. We got a young lawyer up and coming, and he will be a good lawyer when he graduates. And he has got a heart to serve. And together with Raman, who has been a consultant who was in the fire services, who has now been working with a lot of experience. We are not a team inferior to the PAP's team. So we urge you to consider making a change, giving the alternative party a chance to prove ourselves that we are going to value add and make a difference in parliament. Let me move next to another more national issue before I talk about some local issues. That is on prosperity. We all know Singapore technically is a rich country, but you also see the uncle, auntie pushing cart, you know, collecting cardboard, cleaning, working in a hawker center. I can tell you, when I was in China for a number of years, I've seen the changes over time. The same uncle and auntie in Singapore pushing cart, the same generation in China, they are in the park in the night doing dancing, enjoying their retirement, doing Tai Chi in the morning. And the life that they have, I find it's very shameful for us to come back and see our own uncle and auntie doing different things that they ought not be doing. In Chinese, they say, our own people are not doing that. If an uncle or auntie wants to work because they enjoy doing work, it's fine. Our elderly should not have to work to earn a living. That is wrong. So you may say, wow, do you want to be a communist party or what? No. But what we are saying is the policies that we formulate must make sure the gap between the haves and the have-not must be pulled, but there must be a strong social safety net. And that cannot be a topic now when we have a crisis. Why wasn't a strong safety net built 10 years ago or beginning to build 10 years ago? If we have a strong social safety net during this crisis, we don't have to worry about giving people $500, $600. They will have enough to take care of them. Maybe if we have better policies, there'll be more money in CPF for them to use to tie over. So it is a question of, do we do patchwork when there's a crisis, or do we make sure we do preventive work? It's just like in medicine. Do we do preventive health or do curative health? So you do not treat a person with high blood pressure by giving every day Panadol. You could treat the source and restructure so that he can be brought to health from the source of the problem. And the trouble is, we do look around the policies that we have and all the schemes that looks nice, it's patchwork. We create a problem and then we patch to solve the problem during the crisis. And it also just reflect on the fact that the AP is running out of ideas. You really run out of ideas, and you can see from year to year it's more of the same. If you do more of the same, as Einstein says, you solve a problem with the same solution, it creates insanity to expect a different result that comes out. You've got to think out of the box, be creative. And this brings me to nurturing our SME. If you want them to be creative and you want them to be innovative, you must create the environment such that they can go out there and reinvent themselves, you know? So it's going to be bottom up and not top down. You look at Korea, you look at Taiwan, Hong Kong. These are places driven by SMEs. They are successful because they are creative. The environment, the people who are educated, the government won't push them on what to do. But the government plays a role in making sure they set standard and create fair competition and give an environment the help that they need to actually move up the ladder. For instance, making sure that they don't have to compete with big JLC for jobs only on the basis of the lowest price. They will never get it. Give them a chance to survive, they will be able to grow. So in all, what we are saying is that there is no monopoly of ideas or talent by one party. PSP has something to offer. And the candidate that we are putting forth, myself, my team, including Gigi, Dr. Ang, and the rest of all the other GRC, including our opposition colleagues in the other party, have things to offer. Don't write us off as low quality, because today is a different environment. You could see for yourself the quality of candidates that we have. Only you, as a resident of Choa Chu Kang, can give us a chance to prove ourselves to you, to service you. And during our walkabout, there are a few things I want to point out. One is that the PAP has been talking about nobody is going to be left behind. Really? There are quite a few people being left behind. You go to Block 9 on Teck Whye Lane. We were there the other day. The people are living in poverty. I was in Block 813A just last night talking to some resident. One of them left her job from Changi because of the COVID situation. And she has been struggling to try to find job now because she can't move around. She only could be a job that could be seated. So a main job. She's just telling me there's no chance for her to get a job. Totally very pathetic. It's a really dire situation. You see a middle-aged person, I think 40 over years old. We met him on the lift from the ground floor. We spoke to him. He went up to back home, have an elderly mother, live one room flat. He was telling me they can't even afford to pay the rental. This rented property, rented HDB flat, it's not very expensive, but even then, he has the problem. And we see flat that has got red notices outside for overdue rental, probably nobody inside there. So all these are signs of people really being left behind. going back again to the social safety net. We must create it and don't wait for a crisis to talk about creating a social safety net. A government must have foresight, must understand what are the challenges that's going to come and actually anticipate what we can do and be able to think out of the box to look at ideas. Even you look at industries, look at business, you think of blue ocean strategy, where you're going to go to areas that we are much more, where there's less competition, we are much more able to excel and survive. So before I round up, what I'm going to say really is that give PSP and our team a chance. No longer is just worrying about if this team comes in, we may rock the boat, things will not go well. Not true. Things will continue to go well. Things can only be better. Because if the existing party cannot do any better, there is better hope to get other people to come in and help. We are not talking about displacing the party to rule Singapore. We are talking about coming in to play a collaborative role, constructive role, to help Singapore get better. Because you deserve better. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There was Francis Yuan. Wow, Francis, power to you. Okay. You have taken quite a bit of time to explain broadly the issues affecting Singapore. Okay, now the next person I'd like to bring on is Tan Meng Wah. Can we please play the video for Meng Wah, please, my tech people? Thank you.
I最大的爱好是摄影、爬山。 年轻的时候爱上长途的这个徒步旅行，背了背包，拿了相机就往外跑，一路走过来，面对无数的挑战，最大的挑战将会是这次的大选。大家好，我叫陈明华，今年56岁，南京大学毕业后，我受邀加入国立大学的公共政策研究院。10年的研究成果让我发现，虽然新加坡的政府还是同一个政党，第一代领袖吴思凤现的精神 已经不存在，今天的新加坡表面风光，70-80岁的老人家还要在这边收碗筷、剪纸皮，买房子对年轻人是越来越重的负担。为了我们的下一代，新加坡需要一个能够代表人民诉求、制衡政府的声音。请给我一个机会，让我利用我10年在公共政策研究方面的成果，帮助新加坡走回以人民为本的发展轨道。
And that was the short video for Tan Meng Wah. The floor is yours, my friend. Say hello to Singapore.
Dear Singaporeans, and especially the residents of Choa Chu Kang, GRC, my name is Meng Wah. The COVID outbreak has actually created a lot of uncertainty. And we all know by now that the crisis has been mishandled. And after all the mishandling, what happened? What did the government do? The government is basically throwing money, drawing down on the reserves. How much has been withdrawn so far from the reserves? At least 52 billion. Besides throwing money, another thing that the government has recently trying to do is to stir up fear. Okay, they are actually creating, you know, a very frightening scenario to tell you that what's going to happen over the next few years, you know, but one of the reasons why they're actually pushing for the election to be done now is that this is a period where it is very uncertain. But as time goes on and so on, you know, some of the uncertainty will be removed. That's why they want to push through the election now, so that when everybody is uncertain, you know, the fear element is there. But I want to put things in perspective for you. The pain that we see now, actually, they are at two levels. Some of the pains are short-term pains caused by the mismanagement of the crisis, all right? And they are short-term pains. Your uncertainties regarding your job, your income, you know, for those who could not work during the circuit breaker, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty. So there's a bit of pain, you know, because of the uncertainty. But more importantly, you have to realize that there are many pains that are actually long-term caused by structural issue in the economy. And those pains are caused by mismanagement of the economy. So you have two levels of pain. One level, short-term pains caused by the mismanagement of the crisis. Another level, long-term pain caused by the mismanagement of the economies over the last 20 years. Okay? Now, like any other viral outbreak in history, all right, the crisis will blow over. Why? Because they are now working on a vaccine. All right? Many countries are actually working on a vaccine. So when a vaccine is ready, you know, the COVID-19 will gradually go away and the economy will recover gradually. All right. So the pain will go away as the economy recover from the crisis. But the short-term pains will go away. But the long-term pains, those long-term pains that are already there, even before the outbreak of the crisis, they will still remain. What are the long-term pains? Number one, for example, income inequality. Number two, high living costs. Number three, competition, our employment, the rising unemployment of the PMET, as Francis mentioned just now, at least 100,000. All right. And number four, influx of foreign population. Right? All these long-term pains, they are already there even before the outbreak of the crisis. They will not go away just because COVID-19 goes away. They are there because of policies. And this is where my strength is. Okay, I look at policies. Okay, so I'm trying to explain to you, all right, the government is actually trying to use this crisis to mask all the mismanagement of the economy, of the socio-economic development of Singapore over the last two decades, especially over the last two decades. Actually, in many regards, Singapore government is very lucky. Lucky in what sense? All right, year 2008, you have the global financial crisis. So global financial crisis became an excuse to explain the way some of the problems we are facing, structural problems we are facing. And then 2017, 18, right? Thanks to Donald Trump, we have the trade crisis between the China and US. That became another excuse to explain why our exports have been going down. All right. And now you have COVID-19. All right. So we have crisis that the government can use to explain away the pains that we are feeling, you know, the rising living costs, the rising housing costs and so on, you know, the falling trade, you know, our poor economic performance and so on. Think about it. In the past, we have 8%, 10% growth, and now we barely make 1-2%. Okay. So the question now is, what can we do? All right. I mean, on the surface, everything looks better. Everything looks beautiful. In Chinese, we call it guan xian liao liang li, you know. Everything looks beautiful. But if you really ask yourself, is life really better now compared to 20 years ago? Right? If you are a graduating student, my daughter is graduating next year. Right? If you're a graduating student, are you worried about getting a good job next year? All right, a job that pays a meaningful wage, a job that allows you to do a meaningful, to apply what you learn in a university. Okay? If you're planning to start a family soon, right? Some of the people I met over the last few days, they're talking about, you know, I want to start a family soon. I want to have children. But the moment I buy a house, I got to worry all the mortgage and so on. How can I think of having a baby? Right? I mean, if you are PMET now, if you are PMT, are you worried about losing your job in 10 or 20 years' time? You can be gainfully employed now. You know? I met some of them, you know, in their 30s, you know. Oh, I have no problem. I have a good job, you know. I you know, I'm drawing a decent income. You know, housing costs, no issue. Mortgage, no issue. But many of the PMT, you know, now they are in their 40s. And going forward with the fourth industrial revolution, job situation will become increasingly uncertain. And now with the influx of foreign talent and so on, are you worried about, you know, losing your job to foreign talent? Right? I mean, if you are retiring soon, or if you already retired, do you have enough money to retire, you know, to make sure that you are able to fund the retirement? Especially when a lot of your saving now is trapped in the a house now, you know, and when the resale value is still declining, and it's going to decline further because of the K-lease issue. And if you are a parent, I met a few parents and grandparents, you know, and I asked them, do you worry about the future of your children and grandchildren? Right? I mean, these are long-term issues that has got nothing to do with COVID-19. I just received this. Our lives, our jobs, our futures. This is what, you know, the government is trying to sell now. The COVID-19, all right? Now, what we are dealing with is about our job, our lives, and our future. The truth is, our job, our lives, and our futures have been put in jeopardy over the last 20 years, even before the COVID-19 outbreak, because of all the policies. Okay? The problem that we are facing now, income inequality, high housing costs, all right, influx of foreign population, okay, competitions for job for PMET, all these are driven by policies. These are structural issues, these are policy issues, and they will not go away. They have already become entrenched. They will not just go away quietly, okay, until you change the policies. And this is where our contribution is. Okay, and as I said, you know, my job is to look at data. Okay, I can promise you, what I can promise you is that I'm going to look at the data and I'm going to study the policies. And I'll make sure that I will check on the government. All right, I'm going to ask a lot of questions with regards to income inequality. I'm going to ask a lot of questions about housing, resale value. When I joined the IPS, it didn't take me long to create a spreadsheet, you know, and look at the data, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. And I realized, actually, it's not sustainable. Resale value. Why? In the world of economic history, in the world's economic history, housing investment always end in bubble. Why? Because for it to be a good investment, housing prices have to keep going up so that there's a profit for someone. And eventually, it will definitely end in a bubble. And this is where we are now. Okay, resale value has been going down, actually. Why do you think the government gave a very, very big grant for resale, for the purchase of resale flats? Okay, so we need to really look at this data and we need to attach the data to the policies, okay? And look at the policy, ask questions. Because if we don't, the long-term pains will not go away. I just want to take this opportunity to add to what Kim Ping said about China, about the senior citizen, right? When I was in Nanjing, I was invited to attend a class in what they call Laoren Daxue. It was a building about 20 over story. Every level, all right, that there are classes, okay. One level for music classes, one level for cooking classes, one level for learning Zhongyao, Chinese medicine, one level for learning Chinese calligraphy. You know, my Chinese friends say, hey, you are senior now, you know, you're more than 50 years old. You know, why don't you come along and join me, you know, So I attended a Chinese calligraphy class, and I attended a class on learning Chinese medicine. Okay, and they pay only 50 yuan, 50 renminbi. That was how, you know, that's how the Chinese retirees are spending their retirement. Okay, and when my Chinese and Vietnamese friend came over, I brought them to hawker center, I brought them to restaurants. And you see the senior citizen collecting bowls, clearing the plates and so on. And my Vietnamese friend were very, very, they wonder why Singapore is such a rich country. Why are you making all the old people collecting plates, you know, clearing the tables and so on? I didn't know what to say. Okay, same thing happened when my Chinese friend came over. Okay, this is not right. Okay, a lot of it are driven by policies. Our people become just simply statistic to the policy makers. Okay, and as Kim Ping mentioned, you know, Kim Ping when he visited 813, you know, yesterday, the rental units, I was there too. There's this, Singapore government has this, preoccupation with making sure that everyone owns a flat. One of a family I visited, for example, they have a rental flat, you know, a family of four, they have a rental flat. The wife is actually a foreigner, a Malaysian, who has been trying to be a PR, but for some reason, her application has not been accepted. Okay, so she works illegally. Okay, she said, "Oh, every day I work, I have to worry about, you know, whether, you know, someone will come and so on." Okay, but that's not the problem. The problem is that the husband works and now has a saving of certain amount. I don't want to mention how much amount. The certain amount of money in the bank, in the CPF, and now the HDB is telling them, okay, I give you another, you know, how many months, you know, you need to buy a house. You know, if not, okay, we are not going to allow you to continue to stay in the HDB flat. So she was telling me, you know, I don't understand why the government is forcing us to buy a house. You know, we can make the first payment, but then after that, how? You know, only my husband has a full-time job. I'm basically, you know, my income is not stable. Then what is going to happen? If we don't buy a house, are they going to kick us out? If we buy a house, we make the first few payments, and then when we have a problem, what's going to happen? Okay? And he went to see the MP. They went to see the MP, and, you know, the MP wrote a letter. And according to her, I did not see the letter. To be fair, I did not see the letter. According to her, the MP said, she said that the MP wrote there, please attend to this lady. What kind of letter is that? I mean, if it is really true, as I said, I have to say that I did not see the letter. So I think there are serious issues, and we really, really, people should not be just a statistics to the policymakers. And as a policy researcher, my contribution, okay, to this team is that I will look at the data, I will really look at the policies, okay, to decide whether the policies are good for the people. My friends ask me, hey, is this a good policy? Hey, is this policy good or bad? I say, this is a wrong question. Every policy is good and every policy is also bad. The question is, who is it good for? Okay, you have to look at the policy and decide who are those benefiting. Okay, at what cost? And then those who are losing, you have to find ways to compensate. That is the basic rule of policy making. Okay, so my job, as I say, going forward is to look into policies to help you to address the long-term issue. That is the value add that I'm going to bring to this team. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. There, that was Tan Ming Wah, who is going to examine policies put forth. And as he said very correctly, the problem we are facing today is not because of COVID, but because of policies that were not good for the country, stretching as far back as 20 years ago. Next person I want to bring on is Rahman. Can we play his video first, please? Thank you, my tech people.
Please welcome CEC member Abdul Rahman.
I took the bold step to leave Singapore and work overseas to increase my experience, my knowledge, and also exposure. But I came back to Singapore to join Dr. Tan Chin Bock. Hello, my name is Abdul Rahman bin Muhammad. I'm married with 7 children. 4 are actually doing very well in their own business. The other 3 kids are still schooling in Dubai. I took interest in politics much earlier in the 1980s. Ideologies, democracies, governance, then society. Why do I get involved in politics? Issues that are faced by our citizens. The gap between the rich and the poor, people who are neglected, sidelined, people who could not actually compete equally due to their position in the lower hierarchy of the economy. There must be a sincere involvement by the government.
Dan kami memberi jaminan yang kami akan memperjuangkan kehidupan rakyat yang lebih sempurna.
I found that we have common interests, me and Dr. Tan Chin Bock. We have the same passion, we have the same ambition. I would appreciate for those who actually are very concerned with the future of Singapore to support us to make sure that our future generation are taken care of for the betterment of the citizens.
Right, thank you very much there. That was a video on Rahman. The floor is yours. Say hello to Singapore.
Hello, Singapore. Hello, Chua Chu Kang's voters and residents. My name is Abdul Rahman. I'll be contesting in the coming election for Chua Chu Kang GRC. My favorite subject is actually leadership. We want reliable leaders. People who can actually plan for the future of the country, be very transparent, and also open to discussion. Now, let's look at the report card of our present leaders. Now, I'm not going to make my findings about it, but probably the viewers would be able to see. Now, when we gave them the what we call the high mandate in 2015, they promise that there'll be affordable housing. They promise employment. They promise that they will reduce the income gap. And other promises that were actually explained by my two earlier fellow contestants for this GRC. Now, have they actually fulfilled that? You have the answers. The next question is this. What happened to COVID-19? Have they performed? Now, every country, especially Singapore, we have a what we call a crisis management. We have a pack of it. So the slightest sign we are there, boom, we intervene. We had SARS before. We had the lesson. We had the experience. And what happened to Singapore? In February, as early as January. We heard about this. We knew what happened to Wuhan. And we had a sign in Singapore. A foreign worker was also infected, as well as those returning here from China. And what did we do? As far as the concern, they made the contractors to do all the compartmentation, separation, cleaning, done because these people, these contractors do not have all amenities, facility to do that. They do not. Now, why the government, like Ministry of Labor, NEA, why are they not intervening? Why so slow? Then after that, when they come in, we have this disease spread like wildfire. And now we are suffering from all those consequences due to this. Complacency, ignorant, I don't know. because we have the system. Why is it not implemented in an efficient manner? So now we have to pay for the medical expenses. We have to set up buildings, dormitories, make sure that, you know, they won't actually come in contact, and we have separation, we give them salary. And when is this going to end? Now, I want to know, every day we have 200 over cases. I think yesterday about 186. It's coming down. But the question is this, how many tests do we conduct presently? We were told 1,000, then there was time that they need calibration on the equipment in the lab. Then it went down, the cases. They went up again. Probably they have actually conduct more tests. We were promised 3,000 per day, and probably by then we have close to 40,000 a month. But we have 250,000 foreign workers that need to be tested, need to be treated. So how long more are we going to bear with this? Now, these are mistakes. You judge. All right. Though now they're talking about how they're going to recover the economy, how to handle this situation right now. These are things that anybody can explain because it has already happened. So you can just come up with all those measures and steps to overcome this situation. But the economy, this is unpredictable. The entire world is not going to recover soon. We are affected by the global situation. Our trade, our, you know, being the hub for finances, and also for air travel, and also for, you know, shipment, they are all affected. Tourism, all affected. Anyway, let's not talk about it anymore because they are actually the problem now we are facing. Otherwise, we won't be contesting in this election. And of course, otherwise they won't conduct this election right now. They're taking advantage over the uncertainty right now so that they can have a mandate they call. No, that's not the purpose. All of you know why it is done now. Now, the next thing is that I want to talk about my visits to all the various residents in Choa Chu Kang. We spoke to the elderly, and they are quite worried. The value of their HDB flat is going down. Last time, they were not so worried because somebody promised, we will not, you know, reduce or let the value of the HDB come down. But now it's coming down. Towards the end of the lease period, it's going to be zero. All of us have to face this. Then the elderly now is worried. If they sell their house at a loss, and what's going to happen? They're going to reduce. They're going to get, you know, lesser room, up downgrading. They can't afford to. The three-room flat is already how much? You know, they have, let's say, twice, you know, bite of the cherry already. So the three-room flat may cost around 300,000, but the value of the flat, and how about the extra money they have to do to survive? Now, their CPF savings, all right, their retirement benefits, now is reduced. Anytime it's going to be completely dried up. So where are they going to get money? Now we have the solution to that. Okay, we have the solution to that. It's concerning redevelopment. But I don't want to release so much of this information. Perhaps when I meet our voters again, I will explain to them. But in here, we are just telling you that redevelopment, give them back some of the value of their house so that they can live with new environment, more amenities, more recreation, their ability to mix around with their neighbors, their friends. This is what in our mind. Although some has been done by the government, but there has to be more to it. All right, there has to be more to it. Then we talk about the young parents. When we spoke to them, some of them couldn't even discuss about it because they're not too sure what's going to happen in the future. Their jobs, where they're going to be secured, and their kids have to go to school, and they have to pay for their house. These are uncertainties, all right? Where they go to, we don't know. But probably they want to listen from us. And we are telling them that we will resolve your problem. Let us go into parliament, debate the thing. We're not going to allow this government make their own decision without debating it, without checking the detail. We need to be with them to discuss together for the purpose of alleviating the living livelihood and also the living condition of the citizens. Next, the young single. They too, quite perplexed. They're thinking about their career. Some of them lost their job, and some of them don't know where are they going towards, which direction are they going. They're not getting the job, the kind of job that they actually are looking for. Some of the jobs stolen away by foreigners, you know, these people from professionals, you know, managers, executives and technicians. Some of them lost their job. Some of them not too sure where are they going to apply the next job because it's not available right now. So these are uncertainties. Then you have the school children. They are just oblivious. They're just waiting for what their parents can do, but the parents are worried. Now, what we want to do is early intervention. The children are the one that is going to be our priority. We're going to make sure that we understand their living conditions, all right? We try to help as much as possible, engage the social workers. We provide whatever help is necessary, like giving them iPads for early introduction towards IT. We have to give them laptops when they go up to primary schools, and we can provide, you know, internet through working with some of those subscribers. These are the things that we have to look carefully. We have to actually engage. All the MPs for AGRC must engage all. Talking about engagement, this is very interesting. I asked them, how often does your MP come? No, I don't see them. Oh, are you sure? Yeah, I don't see them. So this is something very surprising. There are actually four. And they told me, oh, there's one young Malay MP used to come, and now he disappeared. Well, he has gone to UT Marsiling to cover what has been vacated over there. You know why. So you see, as an MP, you must be full-time. We're going to be full-time. We have to be there with the citizens. We are not going to work somewhere and come only during the, you know, meet the people session. That's not right. We have to walk, and we have to walk the talk. We have to talk to every citizen and understand each individual problem. One big problem I discover is that the town council performance, dirty market, walkways. There's even a drain has not been covered for the past five years. Now that's terrible. When I was there, somebody gave me mosquito repellent. I said, why? He said, you know, there are mosquitoes. So I said, no, it's okay. I'm walking fast, but I got bitten. See, you shouldn't have mosquitoes, especially in high level. And the grasses are not cut. We have the ease of this release of the CB. We can get contractors to cut them, but they're growing fast and the mosquitoes are hiding inside there. Now, there are other problems too. Today, we walked down a staircase and we found many obstructions. One big, huge sofa was in the middle of the staircase landing. And that means disaster if there's a fire in the building. The means of escape has been cut off. So where are those people who are supposed to look into all these things? They're not there. So for 5 years, if this resident told me that they haven't met them, then there's big trouble. We are not going to let these kind of things happen. We are full-time MPs. We are full-time potential MPs. We're going to be there with you. So the main thing is this. First is that, do we trust this government? Second thing is that, do we need representation to check on them? Number three, are they performing well? Especially on the town council. I can tell you that Francis is a very, very experienced man in multinational corporations. he's able to see things from the helicopter view. Tan Minghua is a lecturer majoring in economics. So he can look at data, he can look at statistics, and he come out with all those reports to us. And we have a young guy, you know, Sean, who's very vibrant, energetic, who can give us all the information regarding the youth, their aspiration, their ambition, what they like to see the next generation going to be. So vote us in. We will perform as per what I've explained to you, Francis has explained to you, Dr. Tan has explained to you. So with that, I conclude my presentation to you and wish you the best during your casting of the votes on the 10th. Vote wisely. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Oops. Right, thank you very much. That was Rahman sharing his experiences and what are they going to do when they get voted into parliament. Next one is the youngest person in parliamentary history who's standing for an election, and he's none other than Chu Sean Ming. Can we play his video, please? Thank you.
Many young people that I meet, many of my friends, when I talk to them about world events, they might tell me about what's going on in China or the US. But when I ask them, you know, how about Singapore, the line I always get is, oh, you know, there's no point talking about it. I get a strong sense of apathy. Hi, I'm Sean. I'm 23 years old, and I'm a NUS law undergraduate. To me, the ideal view of Singaporean society is one where we value different talents and skills as equally as we do that of academic success. A society where we are not defined by our grades, where people know that even if they do something unconventional, they try something different, that it is as valuable as any other career path. A society where people have greater compassion for those who are more vulnerable, to those who are in need, and really lift one another up. It starts from government policies, and that really has an effect on shaping and molding society's viewpoints and beliefs. I may be young now, but I believe it is the duty of every young Singaporean to step forward. Please give me your support. Thank you.
Right, that was Chu Sean Ming. Okay, what he's going to bring to the table, the floor is yours. Sean, share with Singapore and especially the voters and residents in Choa Chu Kang GRC. The floor is yours, Sean.
Thank you, Craig. Very good evening to everybody who is joining us over Zoom and on Facebook Live. And especially, I want to say a big hello to all the residents in Choa Chu Kang GRC, and especially those who we've just talked to earlier in the day and invited us to join the night session. I hope you all have made it to join in and join our session tonight. And I thank you for coming and hearing what we have to say. And from my previous colleagues, what they have spoken, I think you get a sense of where we come from, and hopefully, you know, this informal style where we really speak off the cuff and from the heart, you really get a stronger sense of you know, who we are as people and who we will be, you know, as your elected representatives in parliament, if you give us and when you give us the chance to work for you. In the video earlier, there was one thing that I talked about, which is political apathy among young people, and why I believe it is something that we should change. And this is something naturally that many people have asked me as I've gone door-to-door visiting residents and reporters as well. What is the reason for this political apathy? And today I'd like to touch a little bit on that. What is the cause of it? And for many of you, I think you will know that it is actually something ingrained in us since we were young. It is something brought out in our education system that we are not told to speak on things that are political. And as a result, there is this sense that, you know, hopelessness or learned helplessness, if you will, regarding political matters. And the reality is that young people are deeply concerned about social issues. You know, many of them will tell you about their concerns about, you know, managing race relations in Singapore, about, you know, taking care of the disenfranchised and underprivileged, like our migrant workers, especially with COVID and the foreign worker clusters, the treatment over in the dormitories and living conditions. So it is very clear that, you know, young people do see the need for more activism, if you will, on the social front to solve these issues that Singapore faces. But unfortunately, there is this disconnect that we see. And this disconnect is that young Singaporeans don't feel that the solution to these social issues is by casting their vote on the ballot box to effect a change. Somehow there is that sense that, you know, there is civil society going on, and many of my friends volunteer if NGOs to work with these groups to ensure that there is more help given to these disenfranchised communities. But at the same time, there is that resistance to say, to make that link with politics and say, you know, is there a need for more alternative voices like PSP to come in to champion these causes, which currently the government is not looking after? And if you think about it, that is precisely the issue at hand, because when we talk about NGOs and civil society in general, it is a space where our government is not in, and as a result, we need these organizations to come in to fill the gap, you know, to take care of, for example, migrant workers, TWC2 and HOME and HAGA and so on. You know, these are things that our current government is not taking care of, and NGOs come in to fill this gap. But we see it is not enough, because currently NGOs do not provide that framework to be able to, you know, push for policies. And the top-down approach that we currently have amongst our leaders means that, you know, many of the suggestions by NGOs are not being taken up. So this is why we need more political representatives in parliament to actually stand for you and address these issues that young people and many older generations are also concerned about, the deep inequalities that Dr. Tan has just spoken about earlier. So when it comes back to this idea of young people, you know, I think there is very recent evidence, as many of you will have seen, that there is in fact a systemic issue at play. If you know, just 2 days ago, it was reported that Hwa Chong school issued an advisory to its students, telling them not to participate or talk about politics on social media. And these are to the Hwa Chong JC students who are 17 and 18 years old. And in fact, they doubled down when asked by reporters, and they said, and I quote, "We certainly do not want our students to be apathetic about national issues, but because of their youth, we do not want them to be inadvertently embroiled in agendas beyond their control." And so I think it is very concerning to me when I hear that, because, you know, here we have an education school to tell students that what they are doing is not right, that, you know, now commenting on social media even is something that they should not be doing. And we know young people today, social media is ubiquitous, and is how we connect with the world and how we connect to our friends and how we receive the news that is coming in, you know. So for them, for Hwa Chong to double down and say that schools, or it tells students that they should not be participating or commenting about the general election specifically, is something that I think is troubling. And we see clearly that there has been stifling of you know, political voices. And this is the result of many years of deliberate, you know, policies. And as a result, political apathy certainly grows amongst young people. And this is why we need to step up without fear. You give us a chance, you know, to tell them that alternative voices is something that is necessary. And only when we are in there, then people will see that, you know, political outcomes do affect people's lives. So we do need change quickly in this area, and we hope to be that change in Choa Chu Kang. Now I'd like to talk also about one specific issue that I've met many residents are concerned about. And it is, in fact, I would say, emblematic of a larger macro level issue of our government. And that is the concerns about the new dormitory being built at Choa Chu Kang Grove. So this new dormitory you are sure to know about. It's something that will house 25,000 dormitory workers. And it is something that many residents have expressed concern about. And of course, you know, in Singapore, we understand, you know, Singaporeans, we understand, we don't have this, you know, not in my backyard approach. Many of the Choa Chu Kang residents I spoke to know that there is a need to house these foreign workers somewhere in Singapore. But the issue is this: has there been enough consultation with the people, the residents of Choa Chu Kang, on this matter? Many of the residents I spoke to felt that they had wished that, you know, before this dormitory was being built, that they could have some input and actually talk about, you know, what are some of their concerns if this dormitory was being built near their place. And I see many valid concerns. They talked about, you know, potentially overstretching the current infrastructure, specifically the buses, and whether it will be overcrowding, especially during the weekends in these areas. Do we have enough capacity to accommodate 25,000 dormitory workers, foreign workers, you know, in Choa Chu Kang Grove, given the existing, you know, infrastructure, transport in the Choa Chu Kang area? So I cite this example, and only this example, you know, because many other examples have already been cited by my colleagues. But this example to me is just something that, you know, impresses upon many residents, and it is symptomatic of the larger issue at play, which has already been touched upon by my colleagues, which is whether the government, our current leaders, have the residents' hearts or residents' concerns at their hearts, and whether they involve them in decision making. You know, currently with this top-down approach, they will just prescribe what they think is best, the policies in place, and the bluntness of these policy tools is something we hope to be able to refine if when we are given the chance in Parliament, so that we can ask these hard questions to say, you know, are these being addressed? You know, your concerns, is it something that we can have a bit more participation on, a bit more of a discussion, so that citizens and residents of Choa Chu Kang are brought into the fold when the policy at on a national level with regards to dormitory and housing these foreign workers actually are brought home to them, because it is they are being housed in Choa Chu Kang Grove. So to me, that is ultimately the crux of the issue. You know, how can we build a better government and have leaders who are willing to hear and listen and take the residents' feedback into consideration before planning a policy and before, you know, rolling out measures that may not ultimately resolve the issue in an adequate way. And only when we hear everyone's concerns, then I think our leaders are equipped to make a good decision. So I thank everyone tonight, and I think that would be the end of what I have to say. I look forward to your questions later. Thank you very much. Back to you, Craig.
All right, Sean, thank you very much there. And now we are going to move on from Choa Chu Kang GRC, and we are bringing on the only rose among the sunflowers tonight, and she is none other than Jejin Wong, who is contesting in Hong Kah North. Jejin, say hello to Singapore. The floor is yours.
Today, our country may look very nice outside, but actually it's very sad. We are making a very nice wedding gown for our government, but ourselves, we are tightening our belt, eat lesser, spend lesser.
Hi, I am Jejin Wong, twin sister.
Hi, I'm Jejin Wong. During my younger day, my family was quite poor. I earned a living to support myself by having three jobs. Production workers, giving tuition, also Zao Tibu, illegal hawker, and carry my products, sell in the bus interchange, in the pasar. When the environment officer come, I got to carry my stock and run away. With a basic degree and a master degree, I joined a reputable company and managed to go to China, and there I start my career over 20 years. I start from a finance manager and later became a company CEO and CFO. The reason why I come back to Singapore is because during end of March, I received a call from Dr. Tan. He asked me, Jejin, Can you come back or not? We need your help. We see many problems, but nobody dare to speak up. I resigned from my company to come back. I'm a daughter of Singapore. It's time for me to serve our country. I'm with you. I want to represent you, to speak up for you, whatever you dare not say to the government. Please give me your support. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. I'm Jijin Wong from the Progress Singapore Parties. I'm contesting for Hong Kah North, a well-managed town which is housed for 28,000 residents over 130 blocks of flats. It has been a tiring but meaningful experience so far, even though it's over the last 6 days I have been walking around. So far, I understand from my volunteers that there are more people, both online and offline, start to call that Hong Kah North, that is the battles of the daughters, the real versus the adopted, or call the battles of aunties, or PSP author auntie. Whatever the nickname was given, frankly speaking, it doesn't matter anymore, as we stay united at the end of the day. I want to further emphasize that I am not anti-PAP, as I believe that the current MP, Dr. Amy Koh, has done a good job in the management of the estate. The difference is mainly our stand of differences in terms of measuring the success of welfare. For example, the PAP measure the success of how many firsts or how many get the top 20. While the PSP, the Progress Singapore Party, we are measuring the success through how many the bottoms, poor people, or how many that is far away. Okay, so actually we are looking at taking care of the poorer and have a more compassionate heart to look after the bottoms, that those people that's very poor and suffering, the people. This is how we measure that. We take care of them, to don't let them fall behind as our achievement. So both parties, we have a very similar methods from the root, actually it's the same, but the way we treat it is very different. PAP would like to measure what is the best, the top 20, but the PSP, we are looking at the lower level of people, how many that cannot catch up. This is our stand. We have a compassionate heart. We are trying to help you with our heart, wholeheartedly. This is our differences. So before I give you a more in-depth understanding, let me explain further why I'm back to contest this election of 2020. For a start, this daughter of the nation was actually serving in China as overseas Singaporean. That is me, the daughter. This is because the government of the day was encouraged us to go outstation, okay, to build a globalized world. It is not easy for me to leave Singapore, to leave my friend, to leave my family at that time. Okay, I'm just like the man who go and serve the national service. I am a daughter's to go out as but my duty to help the nation to be globalized in overseas. That is during the 1920s, when I was sent overseas. Okay. So the government at a time in the 19 and the 20, that I believe at a time I really trust the government because I do my duty, I go out to be make Singapore globalized in the outside world. I trust that Singapore was well taken care of by our Dr. Tan Cheng Bock, is one of the leaders at the time, and also other honorable leader, 2G and 3G minister during the 90s and the 20s. However, occasionally, I also hear some tumbling of the Singaporean complaining that they're unhappy, but I still have faith in the system, okay? But what have come across me that I have lost faith in the system is when the first time our presidential election that made me really cannot understand why we said something that is different from it's supposed to be, that have caused me lost the faith in the system. I think you all know very well what happened on our presidential election, that I no need to elaborate further. When Dr. Tan Cheng Bock formed this Progress Singapore parties, I was very shocked and worried for him because he is actually from the PAP parties, wholeheartedly serving the PAP. Why, at the age of 80, he come up and set up our party PSP? Why? Because something had been changed. We have lost the confidence in our government in terms of transparency and accountability. That is what I mentioned in my rally speech yesterday, in my national speech for Hong Kong, 3 minutes rally speech. Yesterday, I say that we have lack of accountability and transparency. And this is a threat to us, actually. This led me to remember our fifth president of Singapore. If you can remember, who is he? I like him very much. He is our first elected president by the people. First elected president is Mr. Ong Teng Cheong. If he's still alive today, he will be 84 years old already. I believe he will also believe in what PSP is doing, the value of PSP. If you look at what PSP is doing with our heart. So we must be very thankful to Mr. Ong Teng Cheong. If you are taking the MRT, I remember that time Mr. Lee Kuan Yew praised him for his stand and wise decision. Okay, let's not forget about Mr. Ong Teng Cheong. He had made this possible for us. So when we're taking the MRT, today, our PAP, I must admit that they have done a very good job in the 70s, in the 80s, and they're setting a very good policy for us that put our country first and the people first. And at that time, we have very experienced politicians that really protecting our country and the law. That we really feel very grateful to our first, the first leader of the generations, the politicians of the country, the PAP leaders. At the time, we feel very grateful for what they have done that benefited us for the last 30 to 40 years, that we have enjoyed the fruits today. Okay, so we are asking why I want to join Dr. Tan Cheng Bock. Because actually going to politician is a very fearful thing for me. It's not easy to be politicians. But I believe Dr. Tan, she really has really feel something that has changed. And that's why at his old age, he can retire already. He said they to po soon yang, which I cannot emphasize on that. But he come out and set these parties because things have changed from the government. So I respect Dr. Tan and I follow him. And that's why I respect him, have the gut and the courage to set up the parties. And I also stand forward when he called me to come back. So how to make it very simple for Singaporeans to understand Hong Kong North, why I'm coming to Hong Kong North. Just for the benefit of the Singaporean and the Hong Kong North resident, why I'm coming forwards. I make it very simple for you. Give you an example of the scenario of a lawyer and a doctors. Okay, I just want to put that PAP is a lawyer. PSP is a doctor. If you remember Dr. Tan Cheng Bock, he's a doctor. PAP is a lawyer that everything they go by logical. Logical means logic, no logic. Okay, by law, law by law. And he will charge people by the time that he spent. And he will not waste the money on it. Everything must count dollar and cents. Okay, if you have a case, you come to the lawyer will charge you. The lawyer will okay, how much is the charge to you and how much to earn from you. But the lawyer will take care of every case. He will not miss any case one. Be it small case, big case, earning more money and small money. The lawyer will take up all the case. Okay, but the lawyer will prioritize If this is a big client, a wealthy client, you spend more focus with you. And if you are a small client, like lesser money, maybe he spend less focus on you. And that's the difference between, I mean, and then I'm trying to explain the doctors. The doctors is the person with emotion, with sympathy, okay? So if you are a patient, you come and see your doctor. The doctor will prioritize your sickness. If you're very, very sick, the doctor will attend to you first, okay? And you are less sickness, the doctor will maybe come later. Whichever urgent, we will attend to you. But the doctor will charge you a reasonable fee. Or sometimes the doctor may not want to charge you the fee if you are very, very poor. But the doctor will treat you like in your kampong, everybody will be treated equally. So what I'm trying to say is that a lawyer, you measure all the dollar and cents, like a PAP, calculated in dollar and cents. And a doctor like PSP, we are more compassionate. We take the patient the same, but prioritize in terms of your sickness, but we treat you the same. I mean, we want to heal you. We don't want to get you, let you fall sick. And we treat you with a compassionate heart. It's not on the first come, first serve, you're rich, I treat you better. No, the doctor will want to heal you, no matter you're rich or poor. So my suggestion to you is that the fellow Singaporean, when you walk to the polling center, think of it, PSP and PAP. PAP is a lawyer. PSP is the doctor, okay? So when you go to the polling center, have this in mind. Think about it. I also want to share with you another 2 points, a takeaway today. It's about HDB. Many years ago, we are promised that HDB is an asset. It's an asset to us by our leader of the country. And we are encouraged to do upgrading, because by doing upgrading, you think that your house will get appreciated. Like when you sell the house, you get appreciated. So everybody is very happy to do the upgrading. At the time, I think Hougang, they did not get this benefit. Okay, then they say that, no, PAP will not let us have this house forever. Okay, and now it's proof that it's correct. When in the 2018, Mr. Lauren Wong have shared his view that the HDB will be zero lies as the lease go up. And he also shared that, please go and look at the paper, because you all don't understand law, right? Don't understand, right? Look at the paper. The paper tell you it's 99 year. What? I never tell you you can have it for life, you know. But our leader say before, our father of Singapore said before, HDB is your asset. That's why my father, your father, papa, mama, work very hard, vote very hard for PAP. We trusted PAP because of the promise they give it to us. We really trust them. Look at it today. This promise have changed. They say, le bo ta che si bo. Ku kwa le paper la. Okay, uncle, auntie, e chai bo. So, it hurt us more. Okay. Another thing, I mean, this is really particular to Hong Kong. No? Those that staying in block 300 plus one, the older flats, 30, 40 years already. And by the time 99 years, the flat will go to zero. And those people that staying in the block 300 plus, the Hong Kong North one, I noted that it's quite a lot of old folks there. They are at, they are 60, 70 already. During the walk around, during these few days, I talked to many of them. They are having a very hard time, struggling for a living. I mean, economy is not well. They are struggling very hard. There's so many uncle, auntie approach me when I'm doing the door knock, the dooring. I mean, knock door to door and the walking, because I already walk around. And some of them even waited for me downstairs, waited for me somewhere to catch hold of me, try to share with me their feeling. I really can appreciate their pain, their sorrow, and their hardship that after so long, they have been working for so many years. At the end of the day, what do they get? HDB became zero, and they still got to struggle so hard. Look at what Francis Yuan had said earlier. Look at the China people. Hey, they retire at the age of 50 or 55. They go to the Guangchang, which means at the playground there, and dance the Guangchang Wu. They are so happy, you know, and they can go holiday. And their national park or whatever they go for, a certain like the Imperial Palace or whatever, huh? During the special occasion, all those people that above 60 retire, free entrance one, no. They can have free entrance to certain of the tourist place. No need to charge one. Singapore, everything got to pay. The old folks, 70 years old, still cannot stop working. If they stop working, they got no money. Okay, this is very sad. We got to work until the day we die. Today, I got an old lady following after me, very long. I was talking to her. She was very sick. She was got to pay medical, and then she was very, very poor. I promised to come back to her. I said, don't worry, auntie. I will come back to you again. And I was busy with some interview. And after the interview, 1 hour later, when I turned my back, she's still around. And I can tell you, she's not the only person. Yesterday, another auntie also the same. And the auntie, I can tell you, I call her auntie, you know. You know what happened? Then I asked her, auntie, how old are you? She tell me she's 58. I nearly fall off the chair. I am 54. She is 58. Only 4 years older than me. I call her auntie. Why I call her auntie, you know? Her hair is all white color. White one, no? All the wrinkle. So bad, no? 58, 4 years older than me. I call her auntie. I say, what happened to you? She say, very stressed. She says she work in Tampines. Just can go be. $1,200. I say, from Hong Kong, no, you go to Tampines. At least 1 over hour there. And then 1 over hour come back, which means you're going to spend about 3 hours on the way. Just go there and pangopi, $1,200 minus the transportation and the time. How much can she left? She tell me, I just lost my job because they say that she's too old because she really look very old. Huh? And then she's also very sick. I'm very sad. People in China at this age, really, guangchangwu, every time after dinner, go out and dancing, really, so happy. I can tell you this is true. I'm 20 years in China. They can be so happy. At that time, when Singapore and China, during my time when I go China, Singapore was up there, one. No. China was down here, one. No. We are so proud to be a Singaporean. I can tell you, now I'm very sad. I don't know what to tell the Chinese. Our people now so feel so bad. The hardship that they struggle so hard just to earn a living. I really feel very sad about that. The Chinese people can go and enjoy the guangchangwu, the dancing. What are we doing? Struggling our meal. I don't know what to say with that. I hope you can think about it. And the next thing I'll talk about the CPF. What happened to our CPF? Our leader promised us, the 2G minister promised us something that our CPF can be at the time withdraw at 50, then you change to 55, now you change to 65, and now after 65, you cannot take everything out. Our government keep changing and changing and changing. When are you going to end it? When are you going to end it? Why you cannot keep your promises to us? You are the government. Run like a government. Keep your promise. Since you're a lawyer, keep to the contract, your promise. Don't keep changing it. You're not professional. Don't treat us like we don't know anything. We are all educated. Just that our people don't challenge you. Singaporean, wake up. You must wake up now. If you don't wake up, you don't make your decision, you let your decision to the government, you're going to think about it. You are going to work until the day you die. I'm not threatening you. I'm very upset. I come back from China. I want to help you. Hong Kong North. Hong Kong North. Why I come to you? I believe. I have faith in you. I have confidence in you. You can count on me. We together. We want to make changes. I want Hong Kong North, you to be very proud of yourself, to call yourself, you're from Hong Kong North, and the Singaporean were very peaceful and thankful to you. You have voted for the changes. We will lead the changes in Hong Kong North. Support me. Vote me to the parliament to make the changes. We want to make the changes. We cannot trust this anymore. We want to lead the life ourselves. We want to make the decision. I spend so much time talking to you, listen to you. Because I want you, I want to hear you, I want the decision is from the people, to make the decision that you like and you're happy and ready for you. If you want other to make the decision for you, you take it, you bear with it, you don't complain. Singaporean, don't complain. If you want your government to make decision for you, this is our government, we trusted very long. I want to make changes. Help me together, we make the changes. We want to make Hong Kong very famous in Singapore. We are the one, small SMC, we can make the changes. I count on you to vote for me to the parliament to make the changes, to make our government wake up. Thank you. I pass it to Craig. Thank you.
Wow, Eugene. Oh, wow. That's fantastic. I love what you just said. Okay. Wow, that's amazing. And last but not least, we have Dr. Ang Yong Guan, who is from Marymount SMC. Can we show his video, please? The video for Dr. Ang. Thank you.
Singaporeans are living in fear. Fear no more. We cannot afford to live in a country where fear is prevalent. I'm Dr. Ang Yong Guan. I'm a psychiatrist. I've been practicing for the last 30 over years, and I run the clinic at Paragon. I was with the Singapore Armed Forces for 23 years, rising to the rank of colonel as a military psychiatrist. I grew up in a very poor family. I benefited from the meritocratic system of the People's Action Party. And I must thank them, I'm grateful. For 15 years, I was doing grassroots work, paying back to the nation. The trend at the moment is very unhealthy. There's complacency at the top. Things are being controlled very tightly. Singaporeans on the ground are feeling very disillusioned, also helpless because they can't do much to contribute to nation building. When you are unable to speak up freely and your speech is curtailed, then you find that your role as a citizen is curtailed. That can affect the soul of the nation. You can be against the People's Action Party, but you can be pro-Singapore. We can together create a compassionate, fair country where people are proud to be citizens with high self-esteem and a deep sense of belonging and patriotism. A nation needs to have a soul. Please give me your support. Thank you.
Right. For Dr. Ang, the floor is yours, Dr. Ang Yong Guan.
Dear fellow Singaporeans and voters of Marymount, as the PSP song goes, a country is not a company. We are not economic digits. Success is not just measured by dollars and cents. People matters. People matter. Singaporeans count. PAP is obsessed in growing the economy at the expense of not building its people. We may be a first world economy, but it's not matched by first world people. So what is first world people? First world people are people who are mature, graceful, compassionate, and feeling secure with high self-esteem. And with a quality of life that enable them to participate in the arts, music, cultural pursuits, like what we heard from previous speakers in China. You know, you retire in dignity and you enjoy your retirement years. So it's not just growing the economy, it's also growing people, making people feel dignified, secure, with high self-esteem. And also a vibrant, innovative group of people with no fear. Fear is not in their psyche. And that's what Singapore should be. And as a psychiatrist, I would like to help in examining the policies and study its impact on the well-being of Singaporeans. Policies that can affect the mental wellness of Singaporeans. And that's where I come in at the national level. For instance, tagging, electronic tagging, seemingly is effective in the COVID-19 crisis. You tag, you trace, you want to do tracing, contact tracing. But people are worried. When the COVID-19 crisis is over, people are anxious. What would you do with the electronic tagging? The anxiety level is high. Would there be an invasion of privacy? I believe there is a petition of 50,000 names petitioning the government to reconsider electronic tagging beyond the COVID-19 crisis. So that's an example of how a policy can affect the mental health of the people. In this case, the anxiety of the people. So the other issue is work-family balance or work-life balance. We want Singaporeans to be able to balance the two and to enjoy life so that their quality of life is not affected. And more importantly, if you have that balance, total fertility rate will not be affected. The total fertility rate is one of the lowest in the world at the moment. So at the national level, that's how I would contribute. At the local level, I want to make Marymount a model constituency and a constituency of 23,500 voters who can feel proud to live in Marymount and their quality of life is well preserved and maintained. Marymount is very unique. It has got a western sector and an eastern sector. It's divided by Marymount Road. And it's a microcosm of Singapore. It has got rental flats in Western Marymount, 5 HDB blocks amidst landed property, and you have the Shunfu Estate near Marymount Station to the southwest of it. And east of Marymount Road, you have Bishan North, divided into two halves by Bishan Street 22. So how do we make Marymount unique? I've been walking the ground. I've gotten a lot of feedback. For instance, in Western Marymount, they are talking about having a feeder bus service. At the moment, it's bus 130. Apparently, not enough to cater to the needs of the residents there. Secondly, West Marymount, the 5 blocks of flats are there for the last 40 over years. And the dwellers there feel neglected. They think that not enough attention is given to the 5 blocks of flats. Today, when I was there, block 23, one of the residents was complaining of smell of urine on the ground floor. And whenever there's a funeral wake, shops have to close because there was no parking space available. And they built a tentage, you know, at the parking area and therefore blocking the streets. There is a double-story car park there, but it has got to be more space created. So question of how to enlarge that car park. So these are local issues. And of course, Block 26 is a rental block and it has its own issues. And we really have to find out how we can assist in beautifying West Marymount. For East Marymount, it's a different set of problems. I noticed many tuition centers in East Marymount. So when I'm in parliament, if I'm elected, I would look into how do we standardize, how do we make sure the quality of the tuition given, you know, is standardized. Maybe perhaps I need to form an education subcommittee to look into it. So these are issues related to East Marymount. Then finally, my opponent, Ms. Gan, first Brigadier General, woman Brigadier General, pilot in the armed forces. Of course, very talented, very capable. But I, in terms of experience in grassroots work, in community work, in her understanding of issues, I think I am more experienced than her. So we will fight it out in the remaining 3 days to see who is better in winning this battle between a colonel and a general. Whatever it is, I look forward to build, to have the opportunity to build Marymount SMC. Give me your vote. Vote me into parliament. You deserve better. Thank you. Back to you, Craig.
Thank you very much. That was Dr. Ang Yong Guan, who is in the SMC ward of Marymount. So, okay, guys, what we're going to do now is that we're going to run a video, which is the speech is made by Yuen Kin Peng, Francis. He is going to talk about a topic that is on the minds of many Singaporeans when you go and vote on this coming Friday, the 10th of July. They have always put the fear into the Singapore. His topic is about fear. And I also like to highlight to all the Singaporeans, apparently, right now, the bookies, okay? Those people are taking bets on which political party is going to be the PAP. They'll have a clean sweep and wipe out every opposition or alternative political party in Singapore, whereby they win 100% of the seats in parliament, which is numbered at 93 for this coming GE. Or will the alternative parties have a breakthrough and deny them a two-thirds majority? So this has been going around, I think, on WhatsApp and social media, whereby they say, okay, this one is going to be won by PSP, this one will be won by Workers' Party. So that is also a very convenient way to put fear into Singaporeans, whereby, hey, I think I better don't vote the alternative parties. Wait, too many of them come in, and then how? After that, no more PAP government, then how? Singapore will be finished or we will collapse all. And through this video that we are going to put for everyone to understand, Yuen Kin Peng explains very well how these tactics are used by the incumbent to put fear into Singapore. My good tech people, can you all please run this video to explain about this fear thing that affects all Singaporeans? Thank you.
My fellow Singaporeans, my name is Yuen Kin Peng. I am a candidate representing PSP for Choa Chu Kang, GRC. From our recent walkabout, we have come across residents who are unhappy but afraid to vote for change. They fear that voting against status quo will rock the boat or destabilize Singapore. I would like to dispel this fear instilled over the years by the ruling party. They have been spinning the narrative that Singapore will go down if PAP goes down. So you should not rock the boat or upset the status quo. Firstly, there is a clear distinction between a country and the party that governs it. The ruling party can come and go, but Singapore as a country remains. Just like a large company which is a going concern with a life of its own, changes in the management team does not threaten its existence. In fact, many corporations make changes to the management team to improve performance. As a citizen, we owe our loyalty to our country. We do not owe our loyalty to the party that governs it. By the same token, the civil service, the armed forces, and all government institutions are duty-bound to serve the country and our people, not the ruling party. Whether there is a change of ruling party or a weakening of its majority status, the SAF and the police force will still be here to protect us and keep law and order. The civil service will still be functioning to keep our public services going. The hospital will still be here to care for our people. So will our schools, buses, and all social institutions. In other words, life goes on. The fear on destabilizing the country when more alternative voices are brought into parliament is thus unfounded. But there is also the narrative that confidence in our country will be shaken if we change the status quo. Hence, foreign investment and trade will suffer. Again, trade and investments are not based on a single factor of who is running the country, but many other considerations. Singapore, with its established reputation, cannot simply be written off as unattractive just because the ruling party loses seats in the parliament. If that is the case, countries like Japan, Thailand, and South Korea would have gone down the drain each time there is a change of government. The right to choose who we want to represent us in parliament is a constitutional right. We need to exercise this right under no duress or fear. In the end, it is your own decision on what is good for you and the country. We are loyal to our country. We want a government that serves the interests of our people. We cannot change the fact that we are Singaporeans. We are proud of this fact. But we certainly can change the way how Singapore should be governed by choosing who to be our voice in parliament. Our country has lost its direction. We need change to bring it back on track. You have the right to vote for this change. Exercise it wisely and without fear. You deserve better. Thank you.
Right, thank you very much. That was a video by Yuan Kinping, Francis, talking about the fear factor in Singapore politics, whereby Singaporeans have been conditioned through the years that if the PAP is no longer in control, Singapore will be finished. Okay, folks, it's now 5 minutes to 10 based on the clock that I have on my wall thereabouts. So we are supposed to end this session at 10. So how now? We are going to extend the session by another half an hour more to about 10:30. And we hope that people will stay locked on with us, because right now we're going to take questions from the floor. So all my panel, one of the questions that has been popping up is, what are y'all going to propose, PSP, about the HDB lease decay issue? That seems to be one of the questions that has been repeated many times over. What do y'all propose as a solution so that Singaporeans who are caught in this conundrum, how to solve this HDB problem for many Singaporeans? Anyone from the panel wants to take this question, please? Just have to raise your hands and I know that you want to answer to this question. What is PSP's solution or proposal to solving this problem? Yes, Francis, the floor is yours, Kinping. Yes.
Okay, it's, we alluded to in our manifesto. First of all, I hope people realize that the price to pay for the flat has almost 60% of the element that is the cost of land imputed at market rate. So it's very highly costed. In the old days, actually, that is not the kind of percentage we're talking about. In fact, land was to subsidize. But that's another issue. But the owners have been led to believe that it is an appreciating asset. So after 99 years, now the truth is that it's zero. So we are saying that, you have the government scheme called SERS. We are proposing that SERS must be for everyone. Secondly, that if you do that, what about those who have leased land we're also proposing that you start from zero again, so that it could be fair to people who believe that it was accepted and now suddenly it's not. Of course, then the question you ask, who's going to fund this? We have worked a formula that we think we no need to have a big lump sum to fund it at one go. Over the years, every year, you probably need to fork up a few billion dollars to get this going. But it means that you get a peace of mind of people. And people will not have to worry about the fact that, you know, they do not have a place to go to. They don't own any more property. And those who had the clock started all over again now given time to make sure that they realize that it is now no longer asset to appreciate. It goes to zero really after the 99 years from now. And those who are going to enjoy this or be given the service, we also propose that actually if they do not want to have a new home, they can actually trade in this and convert it into cash into the CPF so that they have money for retirement. And then they go on the basis of renting a flat from then on. So in concept, this is how we're going to go about doing it. There are a lot of details, and of course, there'll be a lot of the details are important. We have calculated, and if you are interested, we can surely share with you the details of how this can be funded and how the mechanism of working this out can be executed and implemented. Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much there, Francis. Okay, next question that has popped up as well. Let me look at it. This question that has been forwarded to me. Hello, I'm a first-time voter in Choa Chu Kang GRC and excited that a party like PSP is competing in my constituency. I have two questions that I want to ask the team. What are your plans for the residents of Choa Chu Kang GRC? That's the first question. And second is that I'm very excited by the question. Let me get that question back. But the first one is, what are the plans that you guys have for Choa Chu Kang GRC as your team right now? Anyone like to take that question, please? And let me find the second question and I'll bring it back to the panel. Yes, please. Anyone? Hello? Anyone of the panel? Oh, yeah, I got the second question. Just I was very excited by Sean's speech during the constituency broadcast in such an uncertain economic time. What are PSP's plans for young people who are facing challenges in finding jobs and very little savings? Yeah. So that's the second part of the question. First part, what are your plans for the residents of CCK, the Choa Chu Kang GRC? And the second one is about Sean's speech during the constituency broadcast, whereby in such uncertain economic times, what are PSP's plans for young people who are facing challenges in finding jobs? So who wants to take on the first question? What are the plans that you guys have?
Let me take on the first question.
Sure.
I think there are many, there are several initiatives that we want to embark on. Firstly, we are going to, this afternoon, for example, the residents I met with complains about inadequacy of bus transport and so on. So there are several initiatives. So one of our initiatives would be to review the current amenities like bus services and also, for example, hawker center. There is a hawker center that's planned to be built, but that is only in 2026. I mean, they built, as Francis mentioned previously, you know, they built the jewels in 3 years, you know, and it doesn't make sense for them to take 6 years to build a hawker center, you know. So that's also one initiative. And some residents also complain, for example, about you know, the resale value of the Choa Chu Kang flats appear to be lower than some other towns like Punggol and so on. You know, as far as resale prices is concerned, for example, it's a question of demand and supply. Okay, it's an indication that, you know, home buyers are not looking at Choa Chu Kang, and that may be because, you know, there are not enough amenities, as I mentioned just now, hawker center and so on. The whole neighborhood that I walk, and for example, you know, there was only one NTUC, one supermarket, and, you know, very few coffee shops and so on. So all these amenities have to be improve upon, so that it makes Choa Chu Kang a more vibrant town. And Rahmat will tell you that we also have an initiative to bring back the Gotong Royong, the Kampong spirit, you know. So we'll look at how we can make sure that, you know, Choa Chu Kang become a vibrant town where, you know, people want to be there. Okay, and so over the long term, you know, Choa Chu Kang will be a town where people want to move in, you know, and that will also bring up the resale value. All right, so there are many initiatives that we're looking at. Of course, there are minor problems, you know, water leaking issues and so on. Those could be addressed by the town council. Okay.
Let me just, before Sean answered the question, this is also important. When you are just left off, Rahman talks about a lot of so-called hygiene issues, you know, either rats or mosquitoes or cleanliness.
Yeah.
In fact, the Bukit Batok, this block, 300 plus or so, we're talking about lack of amenities, especially for the older folks around there.
Yes.
But more importantly, I think you talk about the town council. You know, I believe, given my own experience running corporation, there are a lot of opportunity to improve and to actually drive down costs. If you run it well, you can drive down the cost of managing estate. And that can be transferred into giving back savings to the residents. Hopefully, they do not pay more conservancy, or use the so-called savings in terms of productivity and effectiveness to do more for that estate. You know, we believe that in anything you do, there's always room to improve. And the team here has the knowledge, the experience to do it, plus Dr. Tan has bags and years of experience running town council. We are very confident that we can do a better job than what it is. Thank you.
Right, Sean, want to answer that question, Sean?
Yes, I will actually add on to what Dr. Tan Meng Wah and my colleague Kin Peng has mentioned as well in relation to our plans for Choa Chu Kang residents, just a little bit. And then, of course, I think the second question, since it was with reference to my speech on the TV broadcast yesterday, I will also address what are the plans for jobs as well. And I do see them as interlinked, and I'll explain why. So in relation to our plans with Choa Chu Kang, I think we have mentioned quite a few already just now. I would just like to add some of a few other ideas that we have to improve the area. So my colleague Meng Wah has talked about the increase in costs. I mean, to talk about the food options and pushing for the hawker centers. And that is something we definitely want, because one of the feedback we hear from many residents is the lack of food options nearby, especially halal food options, especially good food choices. And actually, this has to do with the high rental costs in the area with regard to hawker or say coffee shops. So we know Choa Chu Kang has no hawker centers. There's plans to build one in 2026. And we believe, of course, as Meng Wah has mentioned, that it can be built faster, you know, before the deadline, before, you know, the next 6 years, I think is too long, and we believe we can push for it to build sooner. But there is also the other issue of the rising cost of food and how that relates to the lack of food options, because many food stalls actually are run out of business in a way due to the high rental costs. And I'll give you an example. At Block 302 Food House, the rental for one lot at the coffee shop is 9,000 after speaking to one of the owners. 9,000, that's very high. That's very high as far as the rates for coffee shop units go. So that actually has an effect on rising food prices in Choa Chu Kang area, and many residents have felt this. And of course, with regards to the lack of food options, because of the high rental costs, many hawkers are unable to sustain the business, and therefore they go out of business, changing hands over time, and that doesn't allow them to maintain the presence and build their in recipes and their brands and really increase the quality of the food over time. So I think that is one area. The lack of food options is a feedback we commonly hear, and we hope to address this. The second one, of course, would be the issue of dengue in the area. So we know the government has, you know, released the Wolbachia mosquitoes to try and combat this issue. But unfortunately, we think it is something that, you know, tries to solve one problem but creates another problem. Because with this release of mosquitoes, many residents have feedback to us that, you know, it has resulted in a lot of mosquitoes swarming the area in the morning. And even though these mosquitoes, you know, may not have, you know, pose a dengue risk, but, you know, when they are small children, when they swarm outside the house, it actually have a concern, you know, that the children, you know, might be flying with mosquitoes lying around. So I do think it is something we will look into and what we can do to solve the dengue, you know, or alleviate this problem of dengue is actually to have more quality control, or I should say enforcement officers. And this is currently under NEA, but what we can do instead of having NEA take on the mantle entirely, we can also employ, you know, local Choa Chu Kang residents who stay in the area, you know, and that is a form of jobs as well. So that, to me, answers part of the second question that was posed in regards to what can we do to help to increase jobs in the area with the concerns over COVID affecting many people's livelihoods. So that is something we can take on with more inspection officers to make sure that there aren't so many, you know, open areas where water is collected. And I do believe it is a source of, you know, gainful employment, at least, you know, for a short-term basis, tied over this time for those who may be struggling with their livelihoods. But I do think also we need to have a plan on a national level to address this issue of jobs. And in our manifesto, we talk about a resurgence strategy. And that really is about providing stronger support for our local SMEs. The fact is that they employ 70% of our workforce, and, you know, 99% of all enterprises in Singapore can be characterized as SMEs. And currently, our economic model as it stands really does not support them sufficiently. There is a lot of support for large companies, MNCs and GLCs in terms of, you know, taxes and subsidies. But with regard to our SMEs, when we conducted our roundtable discussion just a few weeks ago, many of them shared a concern that the sort of the funds that they're receiving, or, you know, it's not sufficient to tide them over during COVID. And as a result, they have to close shop. Many of them also talk about how there's insufficient clarity on how to apply for these schemes and, you know, the paperwork that's involved as well. So we hope that, you know, with stronger support for our local SMEs, that will actually drive an engine of growth in the Singapore, and that will result in, you know, a stronger economic plan that is able to, you know, take us through this post-COVID times that we are in. So I would say that would be, you know, the two-pronged approach to resolve the issues of job security, so that, you know, Singaporeans can feel secure that their future is safe. Yep, thanks, Craig. Back to you.
Yeah, can I add something there, Craig?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead, Rahman. The floor is yours.
Yes. Okay. There are plenty of unoccupied or vacant land in Choa Chu Kang, and they are not fully utilized. Now, we can convert this as a temporary recreational areas, you know, with walking path, cycling, and there's not enough of flowering plants in Choa Chu Kang. It looks like very dull. The trees are all not very well taken care of. So we want to build some of an ecosystem whereby the environment is close to the human. You know, we have flowering, we have maybe fruit plants as well. Then a recreation for children involving some obstacles, some confidence building kind of games over there. So there has to be vibrant. Something has to make the residents of Choa Chu Kang active, something to do during certain part of the day, certain part of the weekend, so they can congregate together. So over there, we can even have barbecue places where the pits there, people can gather around. And we want to bring back, like just now, Dr. Tan said that we want to bring back the kampung spirit. Most of these people were from Ayer Rajah, they were from Teban, you know. Then they managed to purchase a house in Choa Chu Kang, but they lost whatever they had previously. So most of them were from kampung, and they you know, they really want to see that their life is coming back so vibrant. So it's so missing right now. So as though like, you know, you're living in pigeonholes. So that's what we're going to do.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much there, Rama. The next question that I have from the ground, one of the questions, of course, is about, are you guys up to the mark, but have Francis did touch on it a little bit about running the town councils, you know? Do you all have the experience to carry it? So who would like to take on this question, please, about running of town councils? Can you guys measure up? Georgine also can say something. And of course, Dr. Ang can say something as well. So who would like to answer? Just have a show. Okay, Georgine, go ahead. The floor is yours.
Actually, I do not know why everybody is so concerned about running the town council. It's just like running a company to me in China. Managing leave, cleanliness, repair, maintenance. Why make you so concerned about that? We already said it, emphasized so many times. Dr. Tan Cheng Bok has been running town council, okay? And also, we have so many experienced management people, just like running a company. Seeing the government can be running the company, like running government, like running a company, we can also run a town council. Don't worry about that, okay? And trust us, Tan Cheng Bok have the experience, have the expertise to run the town council, okay? Don't keep on asking us the same question. Something relevant would be better, right? Thank you.
Okay.
Let me just add that actually we already have a team of professionals, under the leadership of Dr. Tan Cheng Bok. We already have a team of people who are looking into all the systems that are required to run the town council. We also have the system expert, IT system experts to look at the taking over the IT aspect. We also have Kayla, we also have people who are familiar with auditing and accounting to look into the accounting system as well. So everything is actually in place. And that, as Chi Jin say, this is merely, I'm sure there may be hiccup during the transfer over, minor hiccups and so on, but that's part and parcel of the transfer process, and the learning curve can be very short with the expertise or with the team of the people we put together. So there's really no issue. Thank you.
Right, thank you. Yes, Dr. Ang, your turn, please.
Yio Chu Kang, Kebun Baru, and Marymount are together. And if all three of us win, or when three of us win, we can form joint town council for economy of scale. And this will be back up by HQ with all the resources and know-how. Huh? So not a real issue. In the event only one wins, we can still continue with help from the HQ. And there are other examples. Potong Pasir Town Council and Haokang Town Council. So really, really not a big problem. As Jijin say, it's like running a company. Really not a big issue. Okay, over to you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, this was one of the issues, I guess maybe because the Workers' Party, when they won Aljunied GRC back in 2011, suddenly the software that was used to manage the town council system was pull up away from them to use, So they had to scramble to build a system. But as Meng Wah was explaining just now, we have got Harish who is already got something in the pipeline. So that one, no worries. Because eventually what happened in 2011 was that the former $2 company, apparently the payout was AIM. $2 called AIM, right? And all the software from all the town councils that were being used was transferred to this company. And all the existing PAP managed town councils had to then lease the software from this company called AIM. And because then they could decide from this company's perspective called AIM, the $2 payout company, to decide if they wanted to lease this same software to town councils that are managed by the different alternative political parties when they win the GRC or SMC. So I guess the odds were stacked up, against us. So for those of you who may not remember, that was a trip down memory lane. And it was a real challenge, I guess, at that point in time for the Workers' Party when they won or did the impossible and won the Aljunied GRC. So not to worry, I guess, for all the voters who are watching us right now. This is a problem that... Yes, Meng Wah, the floor is yours.
As I spoke with one of the experts on our, on our side, regarding the town council and so on, and I brought up the issue of Workers' Party, the episode, and he made a very good point. The mistakes made by WP actually serve provides a very important learning lessons for us so that we will not repeat those mistakes. And so we were fully study those mistakes. And so I make sure that, you know, we will stay away from those, problem areas, issues. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much there, Dr. Tan Meng Wah. Okay, another question that we have, and which was one of the reasons why PSP and all the alternative political parties say do not hold a general election during the COVID-19 pandemic. A few people have been asking, we have a multi-ministry task force that is supposed to oversee how they handle the COVID-19. Right now, Parliament has been dissolved. No one is in charge, so-called. No one is in charge. And civil servants from the different ministries have to step up to take care of it. So what happens now if suddenly in your ward, Gan Kim Yong is not voted in, then how? No more health minister. Is that a bad thing? Actually, you could let the other experts come in and take over the job, right? Who would like to answer? Because then you could let someone like Paul Tambaya come in. Yes, Francis. yes, Francis, the floor is yours.
Precisely. I mean, as you have seen in the video that I shared, get worried about the fact that, you know, a minister is not there and then the whole ministry collapsed. There's such a thing called permanent secretary in the ministry. I came from the civil service myself. They are the people really doing the job, the day-to-day operational work. And also the whole army and organization that will not be affected by who the big boss is in the ministry. It's just like in any company, the CEO can change overnight. The company just don't collapse and stop, you know, producing the goods or services. So the same thing, the health ministry will carry on. We've got capable doctors, nurses, and administrators. All will be there. And they are to serve the country. They're not to serve the party. So if any party that goes in to take on, when we win the election, I'm sure there will be a replacement that we can find to take over the job. Or if the incumbent party is still the majority, they can find another minister to go and take over. If they cannot do that, I would ask the question, why is it that do not groom a system that Mr. Lee Kuan Yew has said that must survive the people that manages it? It's like company, you cannot grow a system that will die when the top management goes. It's got to be a going concern. Then it will be the biggest failure of the PAP not to have ministries and systems that cannot run with personality that change. So I would urge all not to be worried about this. The ministry will carry on. The task force will carry on. The people may change in the task force. Like Craig said, you know, we may invite Dr. Tambaya to come in. He's the right guy to come. And other experts to come in with other people with experience dealing with crisis to come in. And for all you know, we may solve the problem faster. Thank you.
That's right. Okay, Meng Wah, the floor is yours. Yes.
Let me just point out that if they're really worried about not having a health minister, you know, to continue, you know, taking care of or tackling the crisis, then they should not have dissolved the parliament. Why did they dissolve a parliament and put themselves in this position? You get my point. I mean,
yes.
They are really, you know, as I mentioned earlier on during my speech, you know, we have just got out of the circuit breaker. Everybody is uncertain. Everybody is afraid, and they set up the sphere, you know, by painting very frightening scenarios ahead and so on. And they are trying to, you know, push the election and to try to win this election where everybody is still gripped by the fear and uncertainty. And that puts them in a position where, you know, Mr. Gan can be voted out. But having said that, as Francis mentioned, you know, the system will continue. All right. Mr. Gan is not indispensable. As what they always tell us in the army, no one is indispensable. There will always be someone who will be up to the task to take over. Thank you.
Right there, Meng Wah. Good point you have made there. Okay, the next one is a bit sensitive, but it shows that we're not going to avoid the sensitive questions. This is from a guy called David Tan from Choa Chu Kang. What is PSP's stand on repealing 377A? gay rights, and do you guys agree to gay marriages? Wow, this is a very sensitive question. So who in the panel would like to take on this question? What is PSP stance on 377A? And do you think is Singapore ready to agree to gay marriages? So anyone from the panel who would like to answer this question? I'm only the moderator, so I'm not allowed to answer on your behalf. Yes, anyone, anyone. What is PSP stance?
John, you want to jump in or you want me to start? I can make a comment first. Basically, you know, I think you have heard Dr. Tan talk about this as well. We were against criminalizing. And this subject is a bit complicated because it involves different values, different so-called thinking, and it needs discussion, it needs understanding from the various community so that we can prepare. But we do take a stand that we should not criminalize. And that is the aspect that we are the standard is very clear. Sean, you are a legal guy, maybe you can give some other take on this as well.
Well, it probably is more than just it's societal, you know, are we ready to accept this kind of thing, taking into effect that Singapore is still a rather conservative society in some respects, right? So these are the factors that have to be taken into consideration. So, Sean, what is your take on this, being a young person? Yes.
Well, first of all, I mean, as Francis has mentioned, you know, we do not object to its repeal if it is only to remove the criminal punishment against homosexuals. But currently, what has transpired with regard to the debate of 377A is that it has become, you know, in a way, a proxy combat zone for other issues. You know, we talk about sanctity of marriage or parenthood, gender identity, you know, traditional family structures. So, I mean, it is a very complex issue. I mean, and Craig has rightly pointed out that it is something as a party we do, you know, we do have, you know, sort of discussions about and you know, different thoughts on. I mean, not that we are not unified, but I think there is a room for diversity when it comes to, you know, viewpoints on such matters. So, I mean, ultimately on these matters, we do feel it is strongly about, you know, removing any kind of discrimination, first of all, would be the key priority. You know, ultimately, you know, what still persists is, you know, unfair discriminatory practices, especially in regards to the workplace. You know, and these are things that we need to look at, you know, as the nation, whether there should be a bias against people for their sexual orientation, you know, when it comes to job performance and so on. So, you know, with regard to 377A, you know, perhaps it is a moral issue. And, you know, one of the best solutions, I would say, if you want to talk about, you know, something which is highly contentious in society, is to call for a referendum, you know, and then that you will be able to see what is public sentiment on the matter. I mean, Craig mentioned that we are a conservative society, and maybe that's true, and maybe amongst the younger people there is a sense that, you know, that we need more, you know, progressive values. But, you know, where do we stand as a society? I think we have to take stock of that carefully, and that means, you know, assessing the situation based on fact. And I think a referendum perhaps is something we might want to consider moving forward so that we really get a true sense of public sentiment on this debate. Yep, thanks.
Thank you very much there. All right, Sean, just like to let you guys know, we are down to the last couple of minutes. And what I want to do is to give each one of you a 1 minute to sum up why the voters where you guys are standing in particular right now is Choa Chu Kang GRC and Hong Kong North SMC and Marymount SMC. Starting with Francis, I'll give you 1 minute to explain why the voters there should vote you guys in to represent them and speak up for them in Parliament. Francis, the floor is yours. I'm timing you guys, by the way.
I want to just relate a very short story with only 1 minute. Within a minute, all of you will remember in the handphone days, in the 80s, early 90s, Motorola and Nokia was number one brand. Apple was a new guy coming in. But Apple became the top brand, and along, of course, with Samsung and Huawei. Why? Because Apple were able to see the needs of its customer, just like PSP able to see the needs of customer. Created a platform that integrate their needs and give them a brand new experience. That means they solve problems, whereas the old party were complacent and believe that they are They know everything. They know all. They know your needs. And do not listen. So they decline. As Mr. Lee Kuan Yew said, there will come a time when people want to choose the other side because PAP either decline in quality or the opposition has an equal team. So I would urge all the people of Singapore, the voters, especially the voters of Choa Chu Kang, we are the apple that is going to develop into a party that gives you new experience, understand the problem of the country, and with the team ready to solve the problem and construct it for the good of Singapore. So give us a chance. We will not disappoint you. Thank you.
Thank you very much there, Francis. That was your 1 minute roundup. Very good. You did it pretty well. Next person is Dr. Tan Meng Wah. Dr. Tan Meng Wah, the floor is yours. Your 1 minute starts now.
Okay. As I mentioned just now, many of the problems we face today are driven by policies. And I'm a policy researcher. Okay, I look at data. Okay, I analyze the policies to decide whether it is good for the people and what policies should be implemented and what policies should be refined. The problem with policies today is that, yes, data is provided, but there are many different ways of looking at data. All right, for example, the government say that, you know, inequality, income inequality is the lowest in the past 18 years. It's now the lowest in the past 18 years. Now, from the same set of data that provided from Department of Statistics, I concluded that inequality is never higher than today. All right. So there are different ways of looking at the data, and that's where I come in. Okay. My job going forward, as I say, my value contribution is to look at the policy, look at the data, and ask questions and get more data. You know, if I need more data to answer questions, my job is to get more data and make sure that, you know, the perspectives, the way of looking, as I say, whether a policy is good or bad, it really depends on who is it good for. And I want to make sure that the policies are good for the people. All right? And that's where my value contribution is. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much there, Dr. Tan Meng Wah. Next person will be Rahman. The floor is yours. Your 1 minute starts now.
Okay, the present situation in Parliament and also in the political scenery in Singapore, we are without proper check and balance. Without check and balance, we have complacency, right? We have mistakes made. We can't afford to make mistakes because it's very crucial now. The post period for the COVID-19 is even more important for the involvement.
Rahman, are you there? We seem to have lost you for a while. Okay, that was Rahman, I think. Yeah, you're back. Are you able to rejoin?
Okay.
We seem to be having some trouble hooking. Okay, you're back. You're back. I can see you on screen. You're back. You can continue.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yeah, in and out. Yes, okay. Please continue. If not, then I'll pass the floor to Sean if you're having some technical difficulties. Okay, yeah, the floor is yours, Rahman, please. We seem to be having some technical difficulties there with Rahman. We'll move on to Sean, please. Sean, your 1 minute starts now, please. Sean, thank you. Yeah, Sean, the floor is yours.
Sure. So, well, thank you, Craig. I think to sum up what has been said already, I would not go further. I would just perhaps share a little bit about what I hope to do, you know, when I'm given a chance to serve in Parliament, which is really to represent the voice of young people. I do feel there is need for greater representation of youth in Parliament. And, you know, it is something, perhaps a fresh perspective that I'll be able to bring to the table. And while I admit there have been right concerns, you know, some people saying, do you have, you know, some of the working experience of my other colleagues here? And the truth is I don't. But what I hope to bring is a different perspective, a perspective of a young Singaporean who has perhaps not gone through the system or, you know, not gone through certain things that have, you know, been perpetuated in our current economic system, and be able to bring, you know, fresh eyes, perhaps, to look at these issues, examine them closely, and see whether there are more creative and daring solutions to the current problems that we face. I mean, it is something, perhaps something to be said about the need for alternatives, alternative voices, which has already been mentioned, but also, you know, representation of young people so that, you know, they feel that their voice is heard and that concerns that they have, particularly among job security and satisfaction, so especially because of the COVID crisis and how it has affected their livelihoods and, you know, in relation to high cost of living and, of course, the BTO prices for many of them who have just started families. You know, I hope to be that voice, to share their concerns, you know, in Parliament, to say that, you know, this is someone who is able to understand, you know, what young people are going through and share, you know, what their struggles are and what their concerns for the future will be. So I think that is what I would say. Thank you very much. Back to you.
Thank you very much. There was Chu Shan Ming, a part of the CCK GRC team. Now on to Jejin. Jejin, the floor is yours. Your 1 minute starts now.
Hi. Actually, my concentration, I think there's two areas. One is a national level. One is that at Hong Kong North. My concentration now, I put on Hong Kong North first. Okay, we have two problems to resolve. One is at a national level. You know what is it? Employment economies. This one I have gathered together with all the forces to get it done. That's why I need your support to push me into the parliament. Send me inside there. Another concern, yeah, concern is that what can I do for Hong Kong now in the next 5 years? Tomorrow, I'm going to share with you my plan for the next 5 years. I'm not going to call it a Hong Kong new town. Town is too cold for us. I'm going to call it a Hong Kong home. Let you be proud of it. It's a really a home with a heart inside that is warm. Something that you look forward to go back for and look forward for. Not Hong Kong town that is a heart infrastructure that have been built. You have built so much infrastructure, but are you happy with it? Is it at the cost of the people? Are we paying for it and yet you are not happy with it? I want to develop a warm Hong Kong home for you. I will share with you my 5-year plan tomorrow. Wait for me to come back to you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much there, Jejin. And the last person that we're going to bring on is Dr. Ang Yong Guan from Marymount SMC. So the floor is yours, Doc.
Not another general, please. If you vote Ms. Gan, you're going to get more of the same. If you vote in a psychiatrist, he will examine policies that have direct psychological impact on Singaporeans. And at the local level, he's going to make a big difference in Marymount. Marymount will be a model constituency, not another general, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much there, Dr. Ang Yong Guan. And we have really come to the end of tonight's e-rally for Choa Chu Kang GRC, including Hong Kong North SMC and Marymount SMC. I'd like to share this with all the viewers who are still with us on Facebook Live and on Zoom. How someone defines insanity is actually, it was mentioned briefly, I think, by Kin Ping, is that doing the same thing over and over but expecting a different result. I think that was how Einstein defined insanity. So do you want to have the same of the next 5 years doing the same thing with the same bunch of people, or are you going to allow a breath of fresh air to come in with this slate of candidates from PSP? They are not going to overpromise and underdeliver, but they are going to underpromise and overdeliver and go the extra mile to represent you, be your voice in parliament, and have the courage to speak up on issues where the incumbent MPs may lack the courage to do so because of their party whip. So with that, I'd like to thank everyone for being here with us this evening, and especially all the residents from Choa Chu Kang GRC, from Hong Kong North, and from Marymount SMC. So thank you. We wish every one of you a good night. And also tomorrow is the last e-rally, which will incorporate Dr. Tan Cheng Bock and his team from West Coast GRC together with Pioneer SMC. So till then, I'd like to wish everyone a great week ahead. Love to all. Thank you for having the patience to stay with us. And we will see you soon when they all march into Parliament with Dr. Tan Cheng Bock. Love to all. Good night and bye-bye. My panel, please wave bye-bye and say bye-bye to all the residents who have joined us here for this evening. We love you all. Bye-bye.
We hope you have enjoyed our third e-rally session. Our next PSP e-rally session with candidates from West Coast GRC and Pioneer SMC will be held tomorrow at 8 p.m. Good night.
Maju Singapura, ini pati. free.